everyone. Retirement is supposed to be a time to relax. One man is redefining the golden years. We'll find out his secret to staying young. Also, the beauty of stained glass is centuries old. The way it is made has not changed too much over the years. We'll spend a day in the life of a stained glass artist, and we'll preview the new movie, Idle Hands.
From the University of North Dakota, with Monty Cashel and Jamie Kasager, this is Studio One.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Studio One.
We're glad you could join us today. Monty, you know what's the best thing I think that could ever happen to a person?
Tell me.
If you're driving around and you see an armored car with all the money in it. Well, in Oregon, a guy who was driving the armored car had the door open a little bit on the back.
I think I see where this is going.
So when he took off, $300,000 fell out of the car. And a Russian couple and another bystander stood by the money and waited till the police came.
So they didn't take it?
They didn't take any of it.
Did they get a reward?
Hopefully.
So you don't know that?
No, I don't know that.
Well, they're good Samaritans anyway. Good for them. On with the show. When abused, alcohol can ruin lives. We'll talk to a doctor who has researched problem drinking in women.
And you may be tired of cooking burgers and hot dogs on the grill. We'll show you how to make your next summer barbecue a hit later on in the show.
But first, today's news with Jim Bush.
Thanks, Monty and Jamie. CNN has learned investigators have found possible suicide note written by one of the shooters in the Columbine High School killings. They hope it may provide more clues as to the reason for the attack. They also found two large propane tank bombs that were located inside the school kitchen. Many residents came to the school today to mourn for those who were murdered on Tuesday afternoon. School officials announced that the high school will be closed for the rest of the year. Investigators are trying to determine whether any other suspects were involved in the attack that killed 14 students and one teacher.
I think the biggest challenge is just the number of items that are considered evidence in this case. I don't have an accurate number, but I know there were literally hundreds of rounds of ammunition fired.
In related news, the National Rifle Association says it is canceling most of the seminars, luncheons, and other activities planned for its upcoming convention in Denver. This is in response to the Denver mayor's request to reschedule the conference because of the killings. The next time you cross the street, you may want to take a look at who is driving the car coming towards you. A new study on the death rate of pedestrians done in New York shows that male drivers are involved in crashes that kill pedestrians three times more often than female drivers. This trend is reflected in the insurance rates for young male drivers. They pay far more than females in the same age group because insurers find they are involved in more claims.
Pretty prevalent that they're going to be speeding and driving quite a bit faster than they should be. If you're going faster, then the chance of more, serious accident is very likely.
States like Arizona are trying to break the trend and last year enacted the nation's first law that defines aggressive driving and sets penalties. America's favorite doll is giving a leg up to the disabled. It turns out that Barbie's knee can help those who've lost part of their hand. Prosthetic specialist at the Duke University Medical Center is converting Barbie's knee joints into the knuckles of realistic-looking fingers. She has found that a dozen people who have lost part of their hand are living fuller and richer lives due to the help of Barbie's plastic joints. The Mattel toy company says they are overjoyed that their Barbie dolls are helping others. High school students across the country will go to prom this spring, leaving many parents concerned about their safety. But at many schools, parents are trying to do something to help their kids.
Prom is one of the biggest dances attended by high school students each year. But when the clock strikes 12 and the prom ends, students still want to party. In East Grand Forks, Minnesota, a parents group called Parent Communication Network sponsors an after-prom party. Like many other communities across the U.S., parents organize the party to keep their kids safe.
We try to have a lot of fun activities, prizes, and give them a reason to want to come. We've got a comedian tonight, and sounds like it's really going over really well. And so we just want to let them have a sober, clean, fun place to be.
The party is similar to a lock-in. Students must arrive within a half an hour after the prom, and if they leave the party, they are not allowed to come back. Area businesses donate gifts for the party, and students must be present to win.
It's a fun way for everybody to enjoy parties without getting alcoholic, getting caught with the cops. doing fun stuff with your friends, you know, hanging out.
And our parents will trust us more if we're here than if we're at somewhere else, and they'll let me stay out later.
The after prom party has been a popular event in East Grand Forks for almost 10 years. Students say word of mouth gets more kids to come back each year.
I come back here every year because of the prizes and the fun and the pizza. And it's just a blast.
Well, prom is one of the biggest events for kids. Parents just want to make sure they're safe. Reporting for Studio One, I'm Brenda Darville.
The Parent Communication Network also sponsors mock car crashes to help kids make the choice not to drink and drive. That's the news now. More with Monty and Jamie.
Thank you, Jim. Looks like there's a few of those high school kids having a lot of fun, getting spring fever.
Definitely. I remember when I went to prom, we had an after thing, too.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a lot of fun. Yes.
A lock-in?
A lock-in.
You can't leave. Have fun. It's an order.
It is. Let's go over now and see what's in order for us at the Regional Weather Information Center with Mike Brookbank for our weather. Mike?
Monty and Jamie, if there's some kids going to prom this weekend, what a perfect weekend. The weather's going to be absolutely downright great in the Grand Forks area. We'll talk about that in a minute, but let's first take a look at our current conditions in Grand Forks. Currently, the temperature's sitting at 55 degrees. The dew point is 25, so the air is relatively dry. The wind is out of the northeast at 21 miles per hour, and our pressure, 30.20 inches of mercury, and rising. Taking a look at temperatures across the region, we really do see how cloud cover does hinder temperatures from rising. 36 at North Platte, 43 at Rapid City, 39 at Billings, Montana, and when we look towards the east, we do see Duluth is at 38, but 50s across all of North Dakota into southern Saskatchewan and southern Manitoba. As for the clouds, you do see on the satellite image, North Dakota and South Dakota relatively covered in the clouds, but you can see there's a slight little clearing up here in northeastern North Dakota, and that's the sunlight we're getting right now. As for the surface map, we do see two areas of low pressure that are teaming up in the southern states, bringing rain all the way from Texas up through Chicago and into Michigan. We do see that will continue probably into Friday morning because these two areas of low pressure are slow movers. But we do see that clearing skies will be moving into the region, so the cloud cover experiencing today will be gone by tomorrow morning. But as we animate into Friday evening, we do see once again slow-moving system, which is now heading towards the eastern seaboard, and an area of high pressure into the northwest. As for lows on Friday, expect 30s down to the south for South Dakota and most of Minnesota and North Dakota, with 20s hanging on to the north for Winnipeg, which is a little bit below normal for this time of year. As for Friday's highs, we'll see 40s to the north with 50s down to the south for Bismarck, Pier, and Sioux Falls. As for the lows on Saturday, well, once again, we're going to see below average temperatures with 20s for Grand Forks and Winnipeg, 30s for Bismarck, Pier, Rapid City, and Sioux Falls. For highs Friday, expect 40s to the north, 50s to the south for Bismarck, Grand Forks, and South Dakota. For all of your up-to-date weather information, please turn to our homepage at www.arwick.und.edu. So get outside and enjoy the spring fever, Monty and Jamie.
Thanks, Mike.
Good. Well, it sounds like we're in for some nice weather.
I'm so excited.
And did you notice on the map, the big map of the nation, you saw that blue, cold mass of air coming from Canada? That's because it's a big sheet of ice up there because NHL playoffs are going on right now.
Oh, really?
They are. And Brian Sean, our sports person, is here to tell us more.
Thank you, Monty. And Jamie. After a grueling 82-game schedule, the NHL regular season is finally completed. However, the playoffs are here and 16 teams are still alive, all striving for the same goal, to win Lord Stanley's Cup. To the highlights we go, Buffalo taking on Ottawa. Vaclav Prosvol meet Alexei Zitnik. Ouch. Buffalo on the attack, Mike Pekka finds a wide open Curtis Brown in front, who beats Ron Tugnutt. Sabres up 2-1. But the Dominator, too much in this one. Dominic Hasek with a save here in the initial Senator shot, and then on the rebound, somehow gets in position to save that one too. But check out this one, the Dominator not done. In front, somehow get in front of that one to stop it. Hasek 40 saves, Sabres win 2-1. To baseball, Oakland at Cleveland, bottom of the 6-2 on for Ben Grieve with a .163 batting average, but he just took the dock deep. Doc Gooden gives up his home run, 3-run shot, Oakland up 4-0. Game tied at 4, bottom of the 9th, 1 out. Kenny Lofton with the sacrifice, A.J. Hinch throws it away. Jolber Cabrera comes all the way back from around from first, and he wins in dramatic fashion, 5-4. Shooting an arrow with a bow may sound difficult to learn, but archery is a sport that anyone can try. That's why many parents and their kids are making it a family activity. In archery 3D tournaments, there are many different divisions based on the age and what kind of bow is used. The sport has seen change recently, where families are participating together. Now that archery is slowly becoming part of the physical education program in schools, Archers are hoping that even more young people and families will get involved with the sport.
They're being active, they're working on their motor skills, they're working on their mental toughness. It's all part of the game, and it's great fun.
Jagger also says that you don't have to spend a lot of money to get involved in archery, because skill is just as important as the equipment you use. And now it's time for the Studio One Sports Trivia Question of the Week. Last weekend was the NFL Draft, so the question is, what year was the first ever NFL Draft held? I'll have the answer to that and more in the second half hour of sports, but first, here's Monty and Jamie.
Thank you, Brian. Still ahead on the show, one couple is using an age-old art to capture the sun's light and use it to enhance their work.
But before that, our next guest is an award-winning researcher. We'll talk with her about her studies on alcohol and women.
We're a very smart family. We wanted a warm house, a cozy fire, hot dogs on the grill, lots of hot water, and saving money. So we chose natural gas from MSP, the wise energy choice.
It's how you look, it's how you feel. You have a style, you have a feel.
When it comes to style, quality, and convenience, Columbia Mall is the area's ultimate shopping destination. With three major department stores and over 80 inviting shops and boutiques, you'll love the way things look.
When you look for more,
we started out as a little old bank, but as your needs got bigger, so did we, and we're still growing. And we want you to know that today, Community National Bank can serve every single financial need that you and your family have. But we also want you to know this, we'll never get so big that you can't get close to us. Community National Bank, we care about you.
The University of North Dakota has a rich history of retaining and graduating American Indian students. UND offers 28 American Indian programs, more than any other higher education institution in the United States. The support services provided by Native American programs ensure student success. Native American programs offer tutoring, academic advising, and financial aid assistance, which makes UND a leader in Indian education. For more information, call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
You're watching Studio One, news, weather, sports, and entertainment.
Alcohol is the most commonly abused drug in the world. Sharon Wilsnack has been studying the effects of alcohol on women for almost 20 years. Thank you for joining us today on the show.
You're welcome.
Well, first of all, if you could help us define a couple things. What is the difference between problem drinking and alcohol and an alcoholic?
Well, usually alcoholic or alcoholism is the kind of diagnosis that a doctor might make of someone with a severe alcohol problem, whereas problem drinking is something that researchers like myself might use more to identify someone who's having problems related to their drinking, maybe school problems, work problems, relationship problems, but isn't yet perhaps diagnosable as an alcoholic.
Okay. In your research, you focus on women. Mm-hmm. Is there any particular reason why you did that?
There's a very special reason, which is that when I started getting interested in this area about 20 years ago, I was a graduate student at Harvard University and was interested in the topic and found that almost all of the research on alcoholism and alcohol use was on men. Actually, even the animal studies, they were doing some studies of goldfish and putting alcohol in the fish tank and see what happens. It was all male goldfish. So there was just nothing done on women, and it seemed like an important area to research.
Since you've started researching, have you found that men are more likely to be problem drinkers or women?
Well, I think in every country that we've studied, men are more likely to drink heavily and to be problem drinkers. But I guess that's not so much the important thing as the fact that women were neglected for so long and people didn't really appreciate the fact that women had a lot of problems as well. So there was a lot of catching up to do in terms of understanding what some of the factors were for women.
Okay. And you recently won a special award. Could you explain what that award was and why you received that?
Well, it was a very meaningful award to me. It was from the Terry McGovern Foundation. That was founded by the family of Senator George McGovern, and his daughter Terry had died, I believe, in 1994 of chronic alcoholism. She had been affected all her life, had been in treatment 20, 25, 30 times, and it had never worked. And she actually died in a snowdrift of hyperthermia related to intoxication. So the family has formed a foundation to try to educate the public about these problems, and they gave this year the first research award in honor of her, and I was fortunate enough to receive that award.
Okay. Now, back to your research. Mm-hmm. Is there a particular type of woman, if you could categorize someone, that is more likely to become a problem drinker?
Well, I would say there might be some, rather than one type of woman, some factors, risk factors that would increase women's chances.
What are those?
Those would be things like having a parent who was an alcoholic, for example. One of the really big ones we're finding is a history of abuse, such as childhood sexual abuse or other kinds of violent victimization. For older women or adolescent or younger adult women, having a boyfriend or a partner who's a heavy drinker is a big risk factor. And several other patterns of employment. If you work a lot in environments where most of your coworkers are male, that tends to increase your chances.
Do these factors also work on the other side, on the male side as well?
Well, that's a really good question, because I think when we got into this area about 20 years ago, because women had been so neglected, we've been focusing on women. Now it's a really good question. Do some of those things apply to men? And I think maybe we don't know as much as we should about that.
Okay. Now, what you mentioned about different cultures earlier. Are there different countries that, you know, sometimes we hear Europeans, you know, have alcohol at the meal times a lot more than American culture?
Right.
Is there particular countries then that do have more problem drinkers?
There's really quite a huge variation. We're working with an international group of about 25 countries. And, for example, Israel has very low rates of alcohol problems, but the Czech Republic has very, very high rates of problems. So there's a lot of variation, but it's interesting within each of those countries, the men still drink more than the women, even though over the countries there's a lot of variation.
Okay, and you've recently put out a book called Gender and Alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
What is this book about? What does it address?
Well, my husband Richard Wilsnack and I edited this, and it really relates to your earlier question about do we know these things about men. It's called Gender and Alcohol. It's not called Women and Alcohol. And it sort of takes the approach of why don't we look at both women and men and how some of society's definitions of gender roles affects the drinking of both women and men, and maybe we can learn more about people in general by studying both of the genders.
Okay. Is there a pattern that you have seen over your 20 years of research that you see in problem drinkers?
In terms of changes over time?
Right.
Well, what we've seen is that from the, say if you go back to World War II up through the 60s and 70s, there was clearly an increase in drinking for women, quite dramatic. It then tended to level off pretty much through the 70s, maybe even a little downturn in the 80s and early 90s. But in our most recent study, which was in 96, it looks like there's a possibility that it's taking an upturn again. So we just got funded to do another study in 2001. So maybe we'll have more answers to that question of whether it's going up again.
All right.
When we do that survey.
Well, thank you very much for sharing that information with us, and good luck in the rest of your research.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Sharon. And Out of Control Hand is the plot of Columbia Pictures' new movie, Idle Hands. We'll preview that movie later. But first, they can be found in windows all around the world. We'll see how stained glass turns plain windows into colorful masterpieces.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business, industry, or organization with our workforce development services. Our experts work closely with you to enhance your workforce productivity. Together, we'll help you develop innovative and practical solutions. The Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in customizing educational programs and services. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the University of North Dakota. The University of North Dakota's Division of Continuing Education can help you learn throughout your lifetime. Begin or continue your education through correspondence study, extended degree programs, and extension courses. For your personal or professional growth, we offer conferences as well as courses in dietary management and real estate.
We invite you to contact us at the Division of Continuing Education to discuss your learning opportunities.
Call us or look us up on the World Wide Web.
The academics are really strong. The professors, they really challenge you to learn and to apply your knowledge.
I think there's many different opportunities in different places that students can go on and off campus.
School of Engineering Mines is kind of one close-knit community. Everybody's friendly. You're not just, you know, a name in the crowd or a number.
I've always wanted to do engineering. What we're learning here is just hands-on.
The department has been very good about acquiring the resources we need.
I think that through this project, I've gained a lot of the team working skills, leadership.
A campus that supports a wide range of degrees gives you a nice ability to round out your education in a variety of areas.
A special touch can turn any ordinary window into a work of art. Stained glass has graced churches and homes for centuries. Today we spend a day in the life of a stained glass artist.
Capturing the sun's rays and converting them into a beautiful piece of art is the goal of a stained glass artist. Gerald Madenwald is a trained musician, and his passion for the stained glass art began with restoring the pianos.
We were looking for kind of more interesting things to do with pianos to sort of jazz them up a little bit, and we came up with the idea of putting stained glass into the music rack.
Stained glass art was developed in about 1100 AD. Since then, the process has remained almost unchanged. Lead usually supports the glass. Due to its flexibility, it can be curved and bent in different shapes. However, lead is poisonous, and many stained glass artists were infected by it in old times. The various glass colors are the results of combining different minerals together. For Gerald, the most exciting part of the process is painting. He uses special paint pigments mixed with glass. After firing the painted spot several times at 1200 degrees, the pigment melts and dissolves into glass. Every 200 years, lead starts to leak, and restoration needs to be done.
Taking an old window that's dirty, you know, it's got 100 years worth of dirt and it's kind of falling apart or it has large bulges and problems, and disassembling it and cleaning it all up and putting it back together, and it's like a new window.
The challenge about this is to match new and old glass as manufacturers change their formulas during the years. By capturing the beauty of the sunlight, Sue and Gerald create a piece of art that can evoke emotions. For Studio One, I am Ekaterina Glad.
Sue and Gerald's most exciting order was from a beekeeper's wife. They had to create a stained glass bee. Evil spirits and murders surround teens in a new outrageous comedy by Columbia Pictures. Idle Hands is a film about 17-year-old Anton who wakes up one morning to find both of his parents murdered. Along with his irresponsible friends, he goes searching for the killer. He finds his own hand may be possessed and to blame. The outcome is good versus evil, and only the winner survives.
It's difficult because, I mean, the hand is basically its own character now. It's got, you know, it's got its own thing, and I have to worry about, you know, the scene and how the scene develops, and I also got to worry about the hand and making it, you know, keeping it going and keeping the character alive.
In order to bring life to the severed limb, a hand magician was brought in to choreograph special movements. The same actor played Thing in the Addams Family movies. Idle Hands opens in theaters on April 30th. Now time to take a look at the events happening in your area.
April 22nd is an awareness day for the Earth. It's called Earth Day. We've asked young people their thoughts on what should be done to make the Earth a better place.
I'd help clean up to make the Earth better and ride our bikes to school more often.
I would ride my bike to school instead of driving, and I would waste less and recycle more.
A lot of people like my age have a problem with littering. They tend to throw things out the car window and stuff like that. So I guess, you know, just cut down on littering and stuff like that.
To recycle and like stop cutting down trees because we get oxygen from.
I gotta be kind of cheesy and honest that I think people need to really like experience God's love, and I think that's like the best thing for the world.
Try not to use like cars for transportation. Try to walk more, or bike more, or rollerblade or whatever.
Okay, to make the Earth better, I think that I'll recycle, not litter, and plant lots of trees and flowers.
Pick up garbage and ride my bike, and put the garbage in the garbage.
A flight student in Florida honed his pilot skills with a cheap computer game. The student had never flown a plane, but he learned so much from the game that he is ranked as one of the top students in his class. Not all students use computer games to prepare themselves for flying.
You are clear for takeoff. Climb maintain 3,000 feet. Fly heading 050.
A real flight simulator might seem like fun for some, but for aviation students, it's more than just a game. Nate Larson has been a flight instructor for 2 years and says the training is very effective.
It's very realistic when it comes to the intellectual aspect of what a pilot needs to fly. You're not going to get the physical sensations such as riding a roller coaster, but the mental load can actually be increased even more than what you'd receive in an airplane.
The cost benefits are very effective because the training in the simulator is about half the cost of training in an actual airplane. In addition, there are many other benefits to a flight simulator.
The simulator can prepare the pilot with the knowledge he needs to actually fly the airplane so that he can transition easier into the airplane at almost no experience.
The students can get training on procedures they do not have the opportunity to do in the air.
Whether you can perform maneuvers near the ground that you wouldn't be able to perform in an aircraft for different levels of safety you have to meet.
Pretending like they're flying in the clouds gives the students an uplifting experience, but landing a real airplane is still a different feeling and one they're looking forward to. Bjorn Rood for Studio One.
The flight simulators are getting so realistic, the instructors are aiming for zero flight time. This means the students get their private license without ever being in the air at all. Later in the show, we'll be firing up the grill outside when we learn how to cook a popular seafood on the barbecue. Plus a look at how one 89-year-old man is using his retirement to do everything but relax. That story plus news, sports, and the weather in the next half hour on Studio One.
I started out in a one-room country school. It was about the only one left in the state. I thought about being a doctor ever since I was a little kid.
Let me take a listen to you here. Yeah. Some big, deep breaths in and out through your mouth, please.
UND School of Medicine, I feel, prepared me very well. The quality of the education was excellent. I definitely was looking to stay in a rural area. A lot of our graduates tend to stay in state. It's a real benefit to North Dakota.
Summer Session 99. We guarantee warm weather. The University of North Dakota has a rich history of retaining and graduating American Indian students. UND offers 28 American Indian programs, more than any other higher education institution in the United States. The support services provided by Native American programs ensure student success. Native American programs offer tutoring, academic advising, and financial aid assistance, which makes UND a leader in Indian education. For more information, call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
The University of North Dakota's College of Business and Public Administration is nationally and internationally recognized as a center of excellence.
We actually created a business plan for this small retail store, which is now being used.
It's introducing me to technology that will be used in my business work environment.
For more information about the UND College of Business and Public Administration, phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
From the University of North Dakota, with Monty Cashel and Jamie Kasager, this is Studio One.
Welcome back to Studio One.
Good to have you with us.
I've got a little, you know, important tidbit for you.
You always do.
I know.
Go for it.
Well, there's a lady in Australia, and she bred a flock of blue sheep.
Blue sheep.
Blue.
So they look blue.
Yes. They're actually like a light blue to a navy blue. They kind of range in shade. And she's been trying to do this for 25 years, and she finally did it.
Finally did it. So the wool is blue.
It's blue.
It's not dyed.
No, she doesn't dye it. She said she wouldn't have time to run around and dunk them all and die.
I suppose not. That would be time consuming.
Yes.
And stupid. Coming up in the next 30 minutes on Stupid One, Studio One, senior citizens often rely on taking medication to stay healthy. We'll see how many are hit hard with the high cost of prescription drugs.
Also, for over 30 years, one man has brought enjoyment to listeners' ears. This man is still keeping his nose to the grind, even though he is almost 90. We'll meet him later.
He is. When you think of summer, you might picture baseball, picnics, and barbecues. We'll show you how to make gourmet meals using your grill later. Mm. Can't wait for that. But first, today's news with Jim Bush.
Thanks, Monty and Jamie. As the air war against Yugoslavia continues, NATO struck one of Slobodan Milosevic's official residences Thursday morning. This bombing is the closest the alliance has come in directly targeting property used by the ruling family. A Pentagon spokesman says they were not targeting President Milosevic or the Serb people. He says the building was a legitimate military target because it contained a bunker and communication facilities. No one was reportedly inside the house at the time of the attack. In other news, a U.S. Army helicopter crashed Thursday morning during a training flight at Fort Campbell, Kentucky. Seven people were killed and four others injured. Officials say the UH-60 Black Hawk helicopter went down at the base's training area during a routine exercise. The Black Hawk is a light transport helicopter that is used primarily for air assaults and medical evacuations. The cause of the crash is still under investigation. Women who smoke during pregnancy may quit more easily if cigarettes cost more. According to researchers at the University of Maryland, many pregnant women want to find a reason to kick the habit. Researchers say if the price of a pack of cigarettes goes up by $1.10, it would make it easier for 30% of the pregnant women who smoke to quit. But one doctor says there is a more important reason for them to kick the habit.
Raising the price, yes, may have some people quit because it becomes too expensive for them to continue to smoking. But I think it's more important about the effect it has on the baby as a reason to quit smoking.
Babies born to smoking mothers are more likely to be underweight and have a greater chance of dying from sudden infant death syndrome. Global warming is melting away ice shelves near the South Pole at an alarming rate. Two Antarctic ice shelves named Larsen B and Wilkins have melted a total of 1,100 square miles alone last year. Researchers at the University of Colorado and the British Atlantic Survey in Cambridge say regional warming has increased the annual melt season by up to 3 weeks over the past two decades. At this rate, it is predicted that much of the ice shelf will be gone within the next few years. Researchers say the meltdown has few implications for the environment, but they are worried that this is a sign that global warming is getting worse. Prices for prescription drugs are rising twice as fast as the rate of inflation. For senior citizens, this is a growing concern because drug coverage is getting harder to find on those on Medicare.
Like many senior citizens, George Longmire has a hefty bill to pay every month at his local pharmacy. Longmire pays around $2,000 every year for prescription medicine to treat his arthritis.
I think it's quite a burden
on, I'm a lawyer and I can pay my bill, but I know many people have many friends that I know that it's quite a job for them. And of course, I even feel it myself. I know that I pay out a lot of money for it that I could be using well somewhere else.
Many Medicare programs do not cover the cost of prescription medicine. This is a big concern for some senior citizens, many of whom have trouble paying for their monthly prescriptions. One pharmacist attributes the rise of prescription costs to improved technology, which takes more time and money.
People that do have to pay it and have to use some of the newer medications, yes, it is expensive. But then, on the other hand, if you didn't have these, you know, how many hospitalizations would you have? Would the age to which you live, would that go down? I mean, the age at which everybody's living has been extended significantly, mainly because the health care has been improved. So what's the price of that? I don't know.
Overall, the prescription drug industry has been very successful. Some companies have profit margins well over 30%. And until new legislation is passed to work prescription drugs into Medicare programs, senior citizens will continue to be a big reason for the industry's success. This is Kirsten Carlson reporting for Studio One.
The money spent on prescription drugs has passed $80 billion annually, increasing 11% every year since 1995. Something found in nearly every home is putting many young children at risk. A recent safety study at daycare centers found that one in every four had cords on blinds that could choke children. Many cords have a loop on the end of them that children can entangle themselves in while they play. Between 1981 and 1995, 183 children were strangled to death on blind cords. The industry is now taking steps to deal with the problem.
It's been enough of a problem in the industry that a lot of the window treatment manufacturers have really put it as a top priority to make innovations and new products that address the issue.
Safer alternatives include remote-controlled blinds and cordless blinds. I've been bringing you the news for the past two seasons. This will be my last newscast. Thanks for tuning in. Now more with Monty and Jamie.
That's right. Good luck in your future, Jim. Well, clap on, clap off for the blinds, remote-controlled blinds. That'd be kind of fun.
It would be fun. Mm-hmm. You could just turn everything off and on in your living room by just like that.
That would be fun.
It would be.
Can we clap and get the weather now?
Let's see. Let's go right now to the Regional Weather Information Center for our weather with Mike Brookbank. Mike?
Well, Monty and Jamie, Mother Nature has clapped her hands and gave us some nice weather right now. Let's take a look at the current conditions in Grand Forks. Currently, we're seeing a temperature of 54 degrees. Our dew point is 25. The wind is out of the north-northeast at 21 miles per hour, so it's a little windy outside, and the pressure, 30.22 inches of mercury and rising. Looking at the jet stream today, we do see that there is a trough carved out in the southwest states, so that allows the cool air from the north to flow down south, but it's really not that cool of air, with the warmer air hanging on over in the southeast, over Georgia and Florida. But as we animate into next week, we do see that that same scenario is set up. There's a nice ridge trough carved out here in the southwest, and the warmer air will be farther down to the south. As for weather, we're going to see an area of high pressure slowly scooting across the international border, but clear skies expected for our region. Just a beautiful day expected on Saturday with highs in the 60s, and that same scenario will be set up Tuesday, but an area of low pressure in the center of the country will bring rain to most of the plains. As for this weekend in Grand Forks, expect the temperatures to be warming up with a slight chance of rain Sunday evening. So if you have a barbecue anytime in the near future, which I've heard rumors about, it'll be nice weather, but a little windy. Hold on to your hats.
Thanks, Mike.
Well, he heard right. We are going to barbecue later in
the
show.
We are.
And I know it is a little windy outside. I asked Mike if he could do anything, but he said he just forecasts. Doesn't do anything in particular. Well, now let's go to sports news with Brian Sean.
Thank you, Monty and Jamie. Not all jobs require their employees to be in tip-top shape, but in Air Force, members must prove they are physically fit. To help determine that, the Air Force makes all its members take an assessment test.
At one time, Air Force members were tested on their physical fitness by running a mile and a half once a year. But this process failed, however, because many members did not work out throughout the year, and a few even experienced heart attacks during the run. Times have changed, and now the Air Force has designed a new program to meet mission requirements.
As a military and as a shrinking force, we need to have everybody to be their healthiest that they can be, especially as we downsize and get smaller and smaller. You want your total force to be as healthy as it can be, so it is a very important factor in our overall military image as well as mission accomplishment.
The assessment consists of an 8 to 14 minute bike test. The individual pedals at a certain speed against a given cycling resistance. The cycle assessment was started to show a measurement of the person's aerobic fitness. Workers in the Air Force are not required to follow an exercise program during the year, but if they fail the assessment twice, a program is set up to help them achieve that goal.
It's a requirement. We have a standard that we have to meet, like a lot of other standards that we have to meet. And we either meet it or we don't.
While this test does show aerobic fitness of the individuals, it may not be a true indicator of overall fitness. The goal of the Air Force Fitness Program is to incorporate a more well-rounded test.
The muscular endurance, muscular strength, and then the flexibility is the piece that we are working on adding into the Air Force Fitness Program.
The new assessment will force individuals to improve their current physical condition, and Steven says that is good considering the level of fitness the military demands. For Studio One Sports, I'm Chrissy Super.
The demands of the military are very strict. Repeated failure to pass the assessment test or maintain a certain body weight can result in removal from the Air Force. And now it's time for the answer of our Studio One Sports Trivia Question of the Week. This week's question, what year was the first ever NFL draft held? It was none other than 63 years ago in 1936. That's all for sports this season. I hope you've enjoyed it. Back to you, Monty and Jamie.
Thank you, Brian. Burgers and steaks are often the choice for cooking on the grill. Seafood can be a little trickier. Our next guest will show us how to successfully sizzle with shrimp.
Yes. Mm. Next on Studio One, we'll see how one man is turning back time with his interesting hobbies. Stay with us.
Pride, the championship tradition, is strong at the UND Bookstore. Before the game, shop the UND Bookstore for the largest selection of officially licensed Sioux products. No matter what your sport, the UND Bookstore can help you show your Sioux colors. The UND Bookstore welcomes all alumni, friends, and Sioux fans. Shop for quality name brand clothing, Sioux collectibles, books, and supplies. Come to the UND Bookstore, located in the Student Union.
I started out in a one-room country school. It was about the only one left in the state. I thought about being a doctor ever since I was a little kid.
Let me take a listen to you here. Yeah. Some big, deep breaths in and out through your mouth, please.
UND School of Medicine, I feel, prepared me very well. The quality of the education was excellent. I definitely was looking to stay in a rural area. A lot of our graduates tend to stay in state. It's a real benefit to North Dakota.
University of North Dakota's College of Business and Public Administration is nationally and internationally recognized as a center of excellence.
They motivate me by keeping me interested in the class, having it more interactive.
Before they can get accredited, they have to meet certain requirements, and it's a good school.
For more information about the UND College of Business and Public Administration, phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Consider extending your learning into the summer months at the University of North Dakota. UND Summer Session is a great opportunity for all students. Summer classes can help you graduate early or on time. Raise your GPA while taking shorter classes with fewer classmates. Summer Session allows you to work and still take classes. Financial aid is available for those who qualify. Classes start in May and June. Registration begins April 6th. Call 1-800-CALL-UND for details. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
News, weather, sports, and entertainment.
The definition of relaxing and taking it easy is different for everyone. Retirement is supposed to be a time when you enjoy life and relax. For one man, retirement is only the beginning of a new life.
North of Grafton, North Dakota, lives a retired farmer who keeps very busy at the age of 89.
It's a kind of a tedious job, you know, but
I like it, and it's kind of fun.
Sig Jagielski has been making clocks with intricate designs for 3 years. He made his first clock after his cousin saw an advertisement in a magazine and decided to send away for the patterns.
The first one I made, it took about 4 weeks, just part-time. And that one there has 5 sections to it.
This clock stands nearly 4 feet tall and has doors and gates that open. The clock was entered in a local county fair and won the sweepstakes award. At the fair, a woman offered Sig $1,200 for it, but he refused.
They're not for sale. They're just a hobby and I want to keep them.
That is not the only reason that Sig has kept all 30 of his clocks. His cousin Evelyn, who lives with him, put her foot down.
She said, you sell the clock and I go. Well, I kind of hated to see her go.
Making these clocks takes a lot of perseverance and determination.
You can't work steady on them because you're going to go crazy.
Many hours of tedious labor goes into each clock. The designs in the clocks are made with such precision that some cuts are only made by a few strokes of the saw blade.
When you put the blade in, probably you just run the saw two, three times and you got to take the blade out because it just takes a little teeny weeny corner.
A few of them have been donated for raffles.
I must have gave away about, 8, 9, just as gifts. And then some went to the churches as raffles and, fall suppers and so on.
Sig spends quite a bit of time working with clocks in the wintertime, and he also keeps himself busy with another job.
Time, we got 20 minutes past the hour, 30 degrees above on the outside. I like to make the people happy. If they like the selections, I play for them, and so that's what I do.
Uncle Sig's old-time show has been on the air for 39 years. He got his start translating Polish records that may have had questionable lyrics.
He said, why don't you get on the mic and translated what it is. So I went on there and tried some of them out, and there was nothing wrong with them.
Uncle Sig started his show back in the late 1950s on Saturday nights. After the first show, people were calling the station wondering if Sig was going to come back. After a couple of years of being on the air Saturday nights, the show was moved to Sunday afternoons, where it has been for nearly 35 years.
This year is something that, it's a hobby. If I can make people enjoy it, I'll do it. And if the sponsors get any benefit out of it, more power to them.
Every year, Uncle Sig threatens to quit, but the listeners, management, and sponsors talk him into coming back for yet another year. Uncle Sig says retirement is only what you make of it. It's easy to see that Sig is enjoying retirement. Reporting for Studio One, I'm Andy Wakeford.
Sig says he is going to try and make it one more year of broadcasting to make it an even 40. Then he will call it quits. Something good. We'll be going outside the studio to learn how to barbecue some shrimp and fish. Stay with us.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business, industry, or organization with our workforce development services. Our experts work closely with you to enhance your workforce productivity. Together, we'll help you develop innovative and practical solutions. The Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in customizing educational programs and services. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the University of North Dakota.
School of Engineering Mines is, we're kind of one close-knit community. Everybody's friendly. You're not just, a name in the crowd or a number.
I've always wanted to do engineering. What we're learning here is just hands-on.
The department has been very good about acquiring the resources we need.
I think that through this project I've gained a lot of the team working skills, leadership.
A campus that supports a wide range of degrees gives you a nice ability to round out your education in a variety of areas.
The academics are really strong. The professors, they really challenge you to learn and to apply your knowledge.
I think there's many different opportunities in different places that students can go on and off campus.
University of North Dakota's College of Business and Public Administration is nationally and internationally recognized as a center of excellence.
They motivate me by keeping me interested in the class, having it more interactive.
Before they can get accredited, they have to meet certain requirements, and it's a good school.
For more information about the UND College of Business and Public Administration, phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Spring is in the air, and tis the season to barbecue.
It certainly is. Barbecuing food on the grill is common in the summer, but not so common for seafood.
Right.
On the grill. We've got Chef Kim Holmes here to demonstrate how to...
From Sanders and Lola's. Don't
Sanders
forget that.
And Lola's.
That's my shameless plug, folks.
And you are going to show us how to do seafood today.
We are going to make the effort, yes.
There's already stuff grilling in there. I can smell it.
Yes, we have a piece of salmon with julienne vegetables, a marinade made with rice vinegar, fresh ginger, and lemon juice. We wrapped that up real tight, and that's cooking as we speak.
Okay. And what are some general tips for grilling seafood?
Don't overcook it. All right? Don't overcook it. You have to watch it the whole time. You can't go have another beer or go back to your card game. You have to pay attention.
Okay. Keep your
eyes
on it.
And that's the most important thing, yes. And cook it real hot and quick.
Okay, why do you do that?
To sear the outside, to make it kind of like crisp on the outside and then nice and moist and flaky in the middle.
And what kind of different seasonings can you put on the fish or shrimp?
Oh, it's whatever you like. I mean, in this particular variation in the foil, we do, like I say, vegetables, and there's a little parsley, some garlic. On the salmon here, right here, we've done salt, pepper, olive oil, and a little lemon juice. I did that about an hour ago. The shrimp, white pepper, salt, and olive oil. All right, and then normally I put garlic here, but I didn't want to hurt anybody today.
Now, you mentioned about overcooking fish.
Yes.
Is that something that happens very quickly? Does fish cook quickly compared to other meats?
Yes, it does. It's not as dense as beef, so it cooks like this is steaming in here right now in that package. This fish and shrimp will cook very quickly. If you overcook it, it gets tough and dry. And you want your seafood moist and succulent.
And what are we going to prepare today so we can
get it on. All right, we've got, like I said, we have the, sound like the body, don't I? we've got shrimp we're going to put on here. All right.
Does fish usually stick to the grill?
Well, you asked that in the rehearsal. You know what? I hope it doesn't. I haven't used this grill, but you oil what you're cooking and the grill is dry. So with a little bit of luck, I'm going to hit it.
So you always oil the fish or the seafood before you put it on the grill?
Yes, you do. And it should sear it, and then I'll pick it up and hopefully be able to make score marks on it and make it real pretty for you all to chomp on.
And when you're grilling with different types of grills, what do you have to take into account with the preparation?
The heat. The Weber grill is the round grill where you have your wood or your charcoal on the outside, you put things in the middle, it acts like a convection oven, it circles the heat, and that's probably the, one of the best ways. This is a Duquesne grill, which you can get at Maury's, but I find this to be the best gas grill money can buy. It's very high heat. The amount of temperature that the heat throws off, like the BTUs, this throws off 30,000 BTUs. Most gas grills that are real inexpensive do about 10, 12,000 BTUs.
Okay.
So the higher the BTU, the better the grill.
I've grown up cooking barbecues over wood.
Yes.
I always do wood. And yes. I think it adds a little bit of flavor. What's your favorite way of grilling things?
Wood, as shown at Lola's. We have a wood-fired pizza oven and a wood-fired grill. And we use red oak. The best wood to grill with is apple wood. Olive wood, the harder the wood, the better. But apple wood gives a nice flavor to the whatever you're cooking.
The hard thing to do with barbecuing over wood is that it's harder to control the temperature.
Yeah.
When you're doing seafood, you prefer to have a gas grill then?
Not necessarily. You know, if you are a, if you like the wood, you probably know the different temperatures. And you know, you can buy little thermostats to put in there. Some of them have them in the hood, so you can tell exactly what the internal temperature is.
Well, that side's looking done now.
Well, not bad, not bad. Let's, oh God. All right.
Hey, nothing sticking.
Look it.
I dodged that one.
Now, is there anything that you, when you're preparing this seafood that is so totally different than beef?
Well, that it cooks faster, most people like beef medium to medium well around this part of the world. Rare is easy to do, but the seafood cooks so fast. And that's the main difference. It's a lighter, not as dense.
How about the vegetables? We've had those on for a while. How long does that usually?
This will be about a 15-minute process because you're steaming it, and it's not on the, it is on the heat, the foil is, but I've got double thickness, and when I open this up, you'll get a great aroma, and I think you'll like it. Okay. You folks back there are getting a pretty good whiff.
And is this relatively healthy?
Well, as you know, you can eat fish all you want, and it's very, very healthy for you.
Okay.
But don't be afraid. One of the easiest ways to cook fish the first time is to wrap it in foil with little vegetables, put butter or olive oil or lemon juice, whatever you want. Use your spices that you like. And then you can do individual portions. So you just plop them on the grill, and 15 minutes later, it's done, and there you go.
And in this part of the country, a lot of people, you know, they have walleye and northern and that sort of thing.
Yes.
Can you prepare it the same way?
Yes, you can prepare it the same way. A lot of folks will have those kind of like deep fry gas grills, and they'll bread the walleye and drop it in. Some of the breading you can use for walleye are like corn flakes, soda crackers, combination of the two, or fresh bread crumbs, or just flour, whatever you prefer.
All right. Well, we're out of time, Kim, but we're going to let these keep on cooking, and we'll come back to it a little bit later after the break.
So stay with us. We'll eat some later.
Sioux pride. The championship tradition is strong at the UND Bookstore. Before the game, shop the UND Bookstore for the largest selection of officially licensed Sioux products. No matter what your sport, the UND Bookstore can help you show your Sioux colors. The UND Bookstore welcomes all alumni, friends, and Sioux fans. Shop for quality name brand clothing, Sioux collectibles, books, and supplies. Come to the UND Bookstore, located in the Student Union.
Valor Insurance partners with you in protecting what matters most. For more than 50 years, Valor has built its reputation on its people, its clients, and a commitment to VIP service. Valor Insurance, Fargo, Bismarck, Grand Forks. Valor Insurance understands that the strength of its people is its greatest asset. People that tailor insurance protection that meets your needs. That's the key to VIP service. Valor Insurance, Fargo, Bismarck, Grand Forks.
It's how you look, it's how you feel. You have a style, you have a feel.
When it comes to style, quality, and convenience, Columbia Mall is the area's ultimate shopping destination. With three major department stores and over 80 inviting shops and boutiques, you'll love the way things look.
When you look for more, there's a lot to see. Columbia Mall, you look great to me.
Are you a parent looking for childcare? Do you know what good childcare looks like? Do you provide childcare and have questions? Does childcare affect your business? Do you have employees who are concerned about childcare? Doesn't every child deserve quality childcare? Any questions? Call Child Care Resource and Referral.
Okay, here we go.
Thank you so much for joining us this season on Studio One. We're going off the air because of summer, but I hope you guys will all join us back in October for another season of Studio One.
Another great season, and we've got this beautiful fish waiting for us.
Salmon escovitch. It's a Jamaican recipe.
There you go. And we have a taste tester here. You can go ahead and dig right in. Thanks a lot for joining us. See you again in the fall.
How is it?
Everybody wave.
Woo!